Cast our crowns before you now. Cast our crowns before you now. We give it all to you.
We give it all to you.
We give it all to you. It's your breath in our lungs, Lord. Hey, it's your song on our tongue, Lord. Offer of worship here. Though you gave us these crowns, we'll lay them back down before you. Though you gave us these songs, we'll give them right back to you. Every breath we breathe is yours. Every song we sing is yours. Every song we sing is yours. We give it all to you.
My heart is calling yours. Come. right. Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Morning. I'd just like to welcome you all to Para Vista Church this morning. If you have been following along with us over the last couple of weeks, then you would know that we have been going through the book of Acts. And today we have Pastor Will sharing with us from Acts chapter 6, I believe. So I hope that you gain a blessing from today's service. I hope that we are all able to put away any distractions that we might have from the week or any distractions we have now and fully just be present here as we praise and worship our awesome God. Now, just a couple of announcements this morning. A reminder that next Sabbath, we're having our church lunch here. So this will be after, not straight after church, after our Bible study groups following church in the hall. So we would like to invite you all to join. If you are able to bring a plate to share, whether savory or sweet, then I'm sure the kitchen team would appreciate that as well. Sue and Fred from the Lasting Impressions team would also like to remind those who are involved in that welcome team or anyone who would like to be involved in our Lasting Impressions ministry that they will be meeting in the church next Sabbath at 12:45. So this will be just before the church lunch. So again, if you are interested or you are involved, then if you're happy to just meet here for a brief meeting next Sabbath before the lunch, they would appreciate that as well. And one more announcement from John.
Good morning, church family, and happy Sabbath. In my hand, I hold a brain. We all have one of these. Well, I assume most of us do, because, I mean, if we didn't, we probably wouldn't be standing and breathing and being thinking people. So it's amazing how these little brains contain so much information and can, you know, at the spur of a moment recall something so minute that, you know, you might have just heard off the cuff somewhere and just go, oh yeah, I remember that, blah, 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 blah. And it's these specific qualities which make next Saturday night all the more fun. And of course, I'm referring to the quiz night. Yay, quiz night. So come along, use these bulging brains of ours and just test your knowledge, see what you can remember or what you might have retained, because, I mean, personally speaking, I love to watch some good old quiz shows on the TV, and just sometimes a question comes up and you go, oh, it's that, and, you know, like, how'd you know that? Well, I don't know, I just heard it somewhere and it just pinged in my brain. So if you're interested in coming, it's next Saturday night, 6 p.m. And if you are coming, please register online courtesy of the through the e-news, because we want to know how many people to cater for, how many tables to set up, just so things can run a bit more smoothly, and we'd prefer not to have to, you know, throw together a couple of tables at the last, set some tables up at the last minute. So please, if you're interested, register. All money raised throughout the course of the night will be going towards our lovely carpet project in here. The only money raised not going towards the carpet is courtesy of the fundraiser for the Pathfinder Camperee, which will be in a lovely silent auction. So if you have anything that you'd like to donate that others might be interested in to raise money for the Pathfinders, please donate, speak to Mark. He'll cover it all and let you know what to do, what to bring. We already have a couple of items, and they were quite big ones too, so there'll just be pictures of them because it was like a swing seat or something. So if you're interested in helping the Pathfinders, come along, and even if you can't manage to put together a table eight, we'll pair you up with some other people, and it's going to be a great fun night. So come along, bring your brains, have some good times, and I can confirm there will be prizes. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's great to be here on Sabbath. I was just, every Friday afternoon, I've got two sets of keys, one for my daily use with the car, and then the other is for school. Every Friday afternoon, I'll just put it in my school bag and park it out beside, and because I'm going to eternity. And early this morning, I was listening and I was watching a video clip, Jason. It was someone who discovered the Sabbath. He's been a pastor, a leader of another group. But he just said, oh, it's so exciting to discover the Sabbath. And the whole congregation that he's with is now celebrating. It's way back in the, it's back in the Philippines. And the whole congregation that he has is celebrating the Sabbath, the seventh day of the week. And it's so glad to have this Sabbath because we can rest and forget all our cares during the week. We're going to start with the song, Holy, Holy, Holy. Please stand and join with us. We're going to sing the third verse a cappella. And please feel free to harmonize because this is the best thing that we can praise our God and celebrate the Sabbath. All stand and sing, please. Singing, please be seated.
Good morning, church. Today's offering is for our schools. This helps students to have the opportunity to study at Prescott schools that otherwise wouldn't be able to attend. Please give generously. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you are so generous towards us. Your love has no limits. It embraces all aspects of our existence. Please help us to have the same generosity as you do. We pray that the money that is collected today will help contribute to those in need at our schools. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Fair enough. Would all the children like to come down to the front? Uncle Brendan has a story for you. Yeah, we'll sit down here. Sit down here. Such a blessing to have such wonderful children in our church. Amen. So nice to see your lovely smiling faces today. So we're studying Acts at the moment, which is about the young church. Can anybody here tell me how old is the Christian church? 2,000 years old. That's pretty old, isn't it? Do any of you have any maybe great-grandparents or even great-grandparents? How old are your great-grandparents? Not sure? Yeah. Well, 2,000 years is a lot older than them. So this week we're studying Acts 6. We can tell that the church is around 3 years old at this time. You can ask your parents about that. Are any of you three? No? Well, it's such an exciting time to be alive, and you've got your whole lives ahead of you. So the church was going through some growing pains. Now, growing pains are a good problem to have. Uncle Brendan, he's growing wider, so that creates problems, but you're growing taller. Now, the problems when you're growing taller are generally good problems. So sometimes maybe mum and dad have to get you new clothes, like new shoes. That's kind of problems, but you get nice new clothes anyway, so that's good. Sometimes, have any of you who are older had lost teeth yet? Yeah, but you get new teeth. That's good too, isn't it? So I'd like to show the first slide. So there arose a complaint in the church. Complaints aren't good, are they? No. But we've been learning how the church was very united at this time. They could have disregarded the complaint, but instead they did listen, to their credit. The widows were missing out on food and clothing. God wants us to look after the poor, but some were missing out. The believers were giving money, as we learned last week, but some people were still missing out. So they chose seven men to serve. The disciples, they couldn't do it all by themselves. These were the first deacons. Maybe one or two of you might be a deacon. Uncle Brendan sure would appreciate that. So the seven who were chosen to serve were able to give the food and the clothes to the widows. What does it mean to serve? Serving is when you put others above yourself. Jesus did that. He never stopped putting others above himself. Have any of you ever done anything for mum and dad? What kind of things did you do? And then maybe when they had a birthday, maybe they're busy and you help them out, maybe cooking, something like that. Do you help in the kitchen? That's good. Do any of you ever tidy up your room without being told? Yeah, that's good too. Maybe no. Yeah, the fellow, no. One time when I was about your age, I drew my mum a birthday card. I looked pretty silly. I drew a cat and I said, nothing ever bad can ever happen to you on your birthday. Decades later, I found that my mum had kept that card, and I realised then that it was such a big thing for me to make that card, and it meant so much she kept it all those decades later. So it's things like that, your parents will really appreciate it. So this was the first example of organising, or one of the first examples of organising in the church. What's the meaning of organising? It's a big word, isn't it? It means to arrange in working order, to get things done. God, is a God of order. You see it in his creation, in everything that God does. God is a God of order. And this is order in the church. So we're all part of the body of Christ, and we all have a role to play. Everybody can use their gifts, their God-given gifts and talents for his work. And the body of Christ shows God's plans for us. We use our different gifts for his purposes, together meeting the needs around us and taking the gospel to the world. The apostles couldn't continue to meet the needs of the church by themselves. They wanted to continue in prayer and spreading the good news about Jesus. They needed help. Organizing meant that they could meet the needs, and the church, as the church was growing, so were the demands, and they needed more helpers. What are some ways you can help? I see some of you have already been up here singing. Lapello, you use your musical gifts. We can help in small ways. Lots of small positive acts make a big difference. Even by being here, your smiling, happy faces brighten the church. The snowball effect is when small things lead to bigger things. Small acts of service will lead to bigger things and eventually lead to an avalanche of Christian love and life around the world. We are learning at the moment about how the church grew from a small body of believers, the original apostles, to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. As the church got bigger, there was more things to do. People were given different roles, all important for the church to flourish, and every believer can do their part. Thank you for listening, boys and girls. You can go back to your seats now.
Like to invite Nikki and her care group to come up the front. Hopefully some of you have introduced yourselves to these lovely people over the last couple of weeks. You may have noticed some new faces, and we thought it would be nice to kind of have more of a formal introduction with you guys up the front this morning in front of our church family. So we would like to welcome you here today. And we thought it would be nice for some of us maybe just to learn a little bit more about you. I know you were quite a large group here this morning, but it might be nice if maybe one of you or some of you would like to share maybe first off where you're from and maybe kind of how you guys all met. So would someone like to share on that?
Okay, maybe I'll just answer the first question because there's a lot of us, where most of these guys are from. So this is Neil. He is from Vietnam. There's Brazil, Chile, Brazil, 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 Brazil. Yeah. And we, some of us met, it was just like friends of friends. Others of us just met at BeWell, if you guys have heard of that ministry. At College Park.
So I remember we met the first time in Morpheus Church. So everything started there, just a few of us, and then the group started growing and growing, and now we are pretty much like a 15 or 20. So yeah, that's good for everyone.
Hey, lovely. And so we know that you started sort of this care group amongst each other. So would you like to maybe share with us how it kind of started or how it came about? Was this something that you were praying about, just kind of fell together, or how did it come together?
I don't want to hog the mic, so I'm just seeing if anyone else wants to talk. So I've been a part of care groups for many years, and I was praying about it for quite some time, and I felt God was shutting doors and opening doors. And I, just like George mentioned, we had a youth rally at Morphettville at the very start of the year, I think it was. And that's where a few of us met. And various people came up to me saying, hey, we heard you run a care group. I want to be a part of it. Or that's what some people said. And others said, hey, we want to run a care group. And at that time, I wasn't running a care group. So I was like, what? from then, just had a conversation with some of these guys and said, hey, if you're in, I'm in. Let's do it. And then it just went from there.
Amazing. Well, I guess the last thing I'll ask is there any sort of highlights since starting this care group or any ways you've seen God lead that you might just like to briefly share with us this morning?
I will pass the mic this time.
Oh, it's going to go. Yeah, it's
going
to go.
No.
I'm not sure, really. We just like start talk about that, and we met like Morfeo, and I think the main point was we was here at the after Bub started like drink a coffee, and Paul and Nikki was talking about like okay, let's do it, and just happened and start growing as George said, yeah.
Okay, I guess I'll just touch on the question. So it's been a massive blessing because just having some like one-on-one time, like it's a beautiful thing to have all of us gathered together on a Friday night, but it's a whole nother thing to like spend one-on-one time with these guys outside of Friday night as well, and just seeing like how each of us are, just growing spiritually, asking heaps of questions, and just encouraging each other, not only spiritually, but like mentally and physically. We do a bit of exercise together as well, like running and a few other things. So yeah, we've become a very wholesome group, I would like to think.
Lovely. All right, well, thank you for coming up the front. I know it can be a bit scary standing in front of everyone, but we just wanted to see your lovely faces. So thank you so much. We hope that you feel welcome here. And on behalf of the Lasting Impressions team, we have a little welcome pack that we gave you all. So in a moment, I'll ask Pastor Will to come and just sort of pray for your care group. But then as you walk off stage, if you'd like to collect your little welcome pack. So I believe they've done some specific books for men and women. So if the girls want to come down this way and collect a gift from me, and the boys can go down that way, collect from Simon, okay? But we'll ask Pastor Will to come up the front first and just say a prayer over you guys. Thank you.
Morning, church. Can I just say a couple of things? So I really praise God for what's happening with this care group, which is basically essentially a small group where they share a meal together, they open the Bible together, pray together. I was over there last night, and it was such... They're very quiet on the stage, but I can guarantee you, they are very noisy in the house. They can't stop talking. They were probably there till 11 o'clock. I left after 10, and they were still going. And you may not realize, but they're starting a Sabbath school group just here in the foyer after church, and basically for our brothers and sisters behind me. So let's just pray for them. And I had something else to say, just slipped my mind. But yeah, praise God. Yeah, sorry. This couple here at the end, don't mind me sharing this, Nikki, but they actually just have arrived from Sydney about a few weeks ago. And Nikki was sharing with me that she was sitting here somewhere a couple of weeks ago or so forth, and she just happened to sit right next to this couple, not knowing that they'd just come from Sydney. So now they're in this group, and they're connecting with these beautiful people. And so it just shows that you don't know the person you sit next to. You don't know. So just, I want to encourage you, after church, go up and say hello to someone. Go and connect with someone. If you don't know them, even more so, because that's what we want to build here in our church. So if you don't mind, let's pray. And let's pray a blessing over our ministry here and for these beautiful young people behind me. Heavenly Father, we just want to pray. Thank you for bringing this beautiful group of young people here to our church. And Lord, it just lets me know, Lord, that you are moving in many ways, oftentimes in ways that we may not perceive. But here they are, Lord, desiring to be part of our Para Vista Church, the body of Christ here. Please bless them, Lord, spiritually. I know that they come from overseas. A lot of them are here alone in some ways, and they have very real challenges, Lord. And so just we pray as a church we'll support them, connect with them, and get to know them. And may they feel part of this church. May they feel welcome here. And may we build them up as they build us up. And so, Father, thank you for this beautiful group of people. Just pray you'll bless them. Bless them in their work, in their studies. And just pray that you'll help them to find a stability here in Adelaide. And hopefully, Lord, as a church here at Power Vista, that can find a place of community, a place of belonging, a place that they can call home. And so help us, Lord, all as a church to build that community here in our church. And we do this for your glory and honor. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Let's pray. If you're able to kneel, please kneel. If you can't, and God looks at the heart. So, dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us together on this your day, this special day, your Sabbath. And I thank you for this day that you've ordained for us, Father God. May we honor you today with our lives, even our thoughts, Father. And I pray for the rest of this service that your blessing will be upon it. I pray that you will anoint Pastor Will as he brings your word. Put your words in his mouth, Father God. May your Holy Spirit come upon him and take over him and let us hear what you want us to hear today. And Father God, I pray for all the dear saints of Para Vista Seventh-day Adventist Church, that through the testings and trials of this life that we face each day, that you will show us what's really inside of us, Father God, and that you will help us to overcome our sins, show us those things in our lives that we need to change, that we will become your true church, that we will see a revival in our congregation. Please fill us with your Holy Spirit and use us in the lives of those around us. Father God, we want to play a part in your kingdom and what you're doing in the last days of this earth's history. So I commit each one of us to you, and I pray that you'll help us to overcome and to draw closer to you. And I ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
For our next song, we're going to continue our service because He Lives. It's a beautiful song. It's about assurance that He lives and there's a future, and we can all go to heaven one day with Jesus. Please stand as we sing our next song. Thank you. Because He Lives.
Sent His Son, they call Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy. This child can face uncertain days because he lives, because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone. I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Thanks for singing.
Amen. What a beautiful, an oldie but a goodie. Amen. All right. Because he lives. Praise God. Praise God. So, good morning, everybody. Now, you might be looking at me. I haven't lost my shaver. Starting a new trend. Actually, it was my daughter's birthday on Monday. It's her third birthday. I don't know. I was just contemplating, reflecting. I was like, My daughter's start of a new year, and I said, maybe I might start a different thing. So if you find this a distraction, just text me or something. Thank you, McT, for leading out. I know that a lot goes on behind the scenes in making this flow, and I praise God that we're here. Thank you to our music team. Awesome job, Ryan. Way to go, bro. So thank you. And again, welcome to our, well, don't call it South American because it's not just South American, it's global. So welcome you all this morning. And to everyone here today, our regular members, if you may be here for the first time, I praise God that you chose to spend time with us today. So thank you. So we are continuing our series here in Para Vista on the book of Acts, and the title of our series is To the Ends of the Earth, and it's essentially a phrase taken from Acts 1 verse 8 when Jesus said to the disciples that they would receive the Holy Spirit and that they would be witnesses to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Am I seeing my eyes right, honey? My actual wife is actually sitting here in the right. That is a first. Because if you know my 3-year-old, she's dynamite. Not from dad, but it's a Cook Island side. So we're up to, we're looking at Acts chapter 6 this morning. So if you have a Bible with you, I'm going to share the actual text on the screen. But you know, please, I want to encourage you, read from the Bible as well. You can't believe what's on a screen. You believe your Bible, okay? So Acts chapter 6, and we're looking at this chapter. We'll actually only read the first part because I'll be preaching the next couple of weeks. And next week, we're going to look at the story of Stephen. So Acts 6, the second part of Acts 6, deals with Stephen. So we'll just leave that for today, and we'll look at the first part, okay? So in Acts 6, verses 1 to 7 is where we'll focus on this morning. And we'll see it together. So We might read it on the screen as well. I've actually got it online on, and by the way, sorry, to our online live audience. God bless you. Actually, you know what? I've got the text in just a moment. Let's read it from the Bible. Acts 6 and verse 1. Here we go. Verses 1 to 7. I'm reading from the New King James Version. Please follow along which translation you have. Now the Bible tells us, now in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplying, there arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. Then the 12 summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, "It is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word." And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith in the Holy Spirit, and Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch, whom they set before the apostles. And when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. Then the word of God spread. The number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. Let's just start with a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, please use me, Lord, this morning. Speak through me as you promised Moses in Exodus 4 and verse 12. Lord, may they not hear Pastor Will's voice this morning. May the voice of the Spirit be heard and felt and experienced today through the word, through the preaching of the word. And Lord, help me to do my best to uplift our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, just a couple of things before we jump into our text. Just want to share with you the mission statement of our world church. And I just want you to see very quickly, as a world church, our mission is to make disciples. Very clear. And we have it in a very particular context. So the mission of the church is to make disciples. And you'll see a couple of references there. Matthew 21 is to make disciples. And so part of our message series this year is we want to be faithful to what the Gospels tell us, what Jesus tells us. We want to make disciples. Acts 1:8, that's the whole theme of this series. We want to be filled with the Spirit. And we have a context in which we are preaching this message, a very prophetic message, if I could use that word. But when you go to the vision, I'm not sure if you realize this, but as a world church, we're saying to the world that our vision, if you see it there, is we see as the climax of God's plan, the restoration of all His creation to full harmony with His perfect will and righteousness. Now, that's a bit wordy, but I guess the word that I like to see in that whole vision is restoration. I think it's a beautiful thing that and it talks about that in Revelation, remember? It talks about this new heaven and a new earth. So our vision, I guess, as a world church, we're saying to the culture, we're saying to people, hey, our vision is God's vision. We want to see everything restored, humanity restored with God, this world restored, this universe restored. And so that's the vision. But as I was discussing with our elders and our leaders and our board, we were trying to, you know, how can we kind of simplify this vision in a more simple language? So I was sharing with our board recently, I was discussing with our elders, and this is what we're coming up with. Our vision statement that we're sensing where God's leading, and the wording and the phrase is this. And I won't take too long, just a couple of minutes and we'll keep going. Is gather, grow, give, and go. Gather, grow, give, go. Now, does that sound simple to understand? I hope so. So let me just unpack that just for a couple of minutes, then we'll get into our message. So and I'll be probably sharing a little bit more on this in the next couple of weeks. But our vision that we would like to propose and what we'd like to get us all on the same page is in this idea, concept, gather, grow, give, go. Now, each of those words, if you kind of think about it, it's an intentional discipleship strategy. And what I want to submit to you today is that each of these words has a very, I guess, an idea, a concept behind it. So let me just break that down, just a few minutes. Now, it doesn't just include what I'm about to say. It's not limited to, but it's part of the starting point. So when we talk about gather, what are we saying here? I would like to say to you this morning that as a church, gathering is important. We're doing it right now. So part of it starts with meeting together as a church. But obviously it doesn't just stop here, as we heard Nikki saying, right? It begins, gathering is more than just a weekly church. It's what we do outside of church. It's getting together. It's connecting. It's meeting. So gathering. So when you think of your mind, what's the vision of the church? Oh, we're here to gather. We're here to gather as a church. We're here to gather as a community. Then we want to suggest that part of gathering is it develops into growing. We grow in our relationships. We grow in a growth group or a connect group or whatever group it is. Shani has a running group. There is a Wednesday morning prayer group. There is Jeff's Wednesday night study group. There's a whole bunch of groups. And I'm suggesting to everyone, there's the lunch bunch group. Sorry, Anne, didn't put it in the e-news. So there's a plethora of groups. And I'm suggesting, and our leaders would like to say, get involved in a group. Give. We want to encourage us to be a community of believers who give. Now, you can understand that two ways. It's giving financially, giving faithfully and regularly. But as we were discussing with our leadership team, giving is more than just monetary, isn't it? It's giving of our time. It's giving of our talents. It's giving of our resources. So we want to be people who give. And then lastly, the idea of go is very self-explanatory. We want to encourage everyone to get involved in some type of ministry effort. Get involved. Do something for God. Get plugged into a group. Now, I'm looking out here this morning. There's a lot of people here today, but you know what? You can't connect with everyone, but you can connect with someone, right? So I want to just kind of put that out there this morning, that's kind of what we're saying as a church, as leaders. We want to encourage everyone to gather, to grow, give, and to go. And I want to encourage us, for all of us who have accepted new leadership roles and you're in a particular team, that's the conversation, that's the wording I'd like you to kind of be talking about. How are you going? How are we gathering? How are we giving in our space, okay? So you can think of it as a big overarching church thing, but also on a smaller scale level in your groups, and also as yourselves as individuals. So that's my little plug for our vision, and we'll bring this up again next couple of weeks. So this morning I want to talk about to the ends of the earth, and we're looking at the book of Acts. I love the book of Acts, don't you? I love how it's very simple to read, and we really see God's hand moving in this beautiful book. So we're going to look at Acts 6 again. Now, I know we read it, but we're going to look at it again on the screen here this morning. And so on the screen here, this is actually taken from the New Living Translation. So I think the English is a little bit easier. So hopefully that will be easier to read. So let's walk through it together. And I've got a couple of principles I think that we can draw from the text and a couple of ways we can apply this text, I think, broadly speaking, okay? So let's follow the text again. So if we go back to Acts 6, the Bible says, but as the believers rapidly multiplied, there were rumblings of discontent. The Greek-speaking believers complained about the Hebrew-speaking believers, saying that their widows were being discriminated against in the daily distribution of food. So it sounds like a bit of a problem was happening in this as the church multiplied. And rightly so, because if you read the context, what happened in chapters 2 and 3, the Bible says that the church just basically grew exponentially. 3,000 plus were added. Can you imagine if overnight 3,000 people were turning up to the car park? Fred, you have your hands full with lasting impressions. You might not make it after the first few weeks. But can you imagine just the influx of people coming into the church? So the church grew rapidly. And so the Bible tells us about this particular situation there. But then the Bible goes on to say that the church did something that was quite wise, I think. The church leadership actually came up with this plan. And so in verse 2, the Bible says, so the 12 called a what, everybody? What's that word there? They called a meeting of all the believers. And they said, we apostles should spend our time teaching the word of God, not running a food program. Now, when I read that, it sounds a little bit harsh, doesn't it? in some ways, it's almost like the apostle saying, hey, we shouldn't be doing that stuff. We got other things to focus on. But I think there is something to learn here, because the apostles, we get introduced to this word in the New Testament. An apostle is, as some of you may know, it just means one who is sent. That's what it means in the Greek. It's the sent ones. So if you think about it, the apostles were meant to be sent out. And so in the process of being called to be sent, there was a situation unfolding. So I guess Peter and the apostles were saying, hey, God's called us to go out. We can't be too bogged down with what's happening in this current situation. And so I think when you read the text, I believe the apostles are really coming from this mission mindset, as it were. They'd been called by Jesus to go and spread the gospel. And so there was this particular dilemma. So the apostle says, hey, we should spend our time teaching the word of God, not running a food program. Then the Bible goes on to say, and so, brothers, select 7 men who are well-respected and are full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will give them this responsibility. So can I just pause here? What actually happened up until this point? There was a problem that there was the particular women were being discriminated against, the Greek-speaking Jews. And so the leadership says, hey, you guys deal with it. In other words, didn't they, if I could use a current term, they delegated that responsibility, didn't they? They basically said, hey, guys, we've got a job to do. We can't be spending all of our focus and attention on this. Hey, you guys, and I love how the Bible portrays that. The apostles weren't so power-driven that they just wanted to consolidate all their power. No, they said to the church, you guys select these particular leaders. And I love how the apostles did this. Interestingly enough, when the Bible, when the apostles gave their qualifications, if you want to call it, it said that they were well-respected, full of the Spirit and wisdom. Now, I thought about that this morning, and I was thinking, full of the Spirit and wisdom. Now, I guess if I talked to each and every one of you today, no one would say, well, hey, Pastor Will, my name is Sue, and I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. We don't like to put ourselves up there, as it were. And sometimes when we look at a text like this, we think, wow, these early Christians must have just been just these super, you know, power, you know, Holy Spirit's just moving in such a powerful way. I think so, but I also think at the end of the day, they were human beings just like us. And so, yes, they were filled with the Spirit, but at the same time, the Holy Spirit was still working on them. I mean, we read about it in the book of Acts. Remember how Peter, a little later, he was, you know, eating with the Gentiles, some of you know the story, and then Apostle Paul comes and kind of berates him because of his double standard. So sometimes when we read the book of Acts, we kind of have this picture of them as these, they didn't do anything wrong, and they were just this perfect church, and there was no problems. The book of Acts tells us there were problems. They chose leaders, but the Holy Spirit was still working in their lives, right? And so here is the text. The Bible says that they were to select 7 men who were well-respected, full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will give them this responsibility. And I love how the Bible continues on in this story. Verse 4, the Bible says, then we apostles can spend our time in prayer and teaching of the word. You know, other translations say prayer and ministry of the word. What an interesting concept, ministry of the word. Now, I was looking into this in research. If you read that text, the word there for teaching and ministry, it's actually almost the same word as the word where we get the word deacon. It really means to serve. That's where we get the word deacon from. It's actually from the Greek word to serve. And if you do a bit of study, that's the same word, teaching, ministry, or even service to the word. So in many respects, deacons and the apostles were serving. Just one was serving in this particular space. One was serving in terms of the teaching and the preaching of the word. So it wasn't like the deacons were down here and the apostles were just these, you know, two, they were too important for that. No. It's like the body of Christ were working together, right? So God was saying, hey, there's some people that's gifted in that area, some people gifted in this area, but this is our role. And here's what I suggest to the church. Every one of us should find a niche, a place, a group, a ministry that suits your gifts, suits your talents, suits your makeup. Some of us can sing really well. Some of us can preach. Some of us can give Bible studies. Some of us are prayer warriors. But each of us have been called to be part of the body of Christ. Amen? And so I don't think that the apostles saying, hey, guys, we're not interested in that food ministry, that food bank program. We're just interested in the Bible. No. I think it's much bigger than that. That there was this sense in which the body of Christ, and this is biblical because in 1 Corinthians 12, we see the apostle Paul talking about spiritual gifts and how God through the Spirit gave certain gifts to the church. Now, then the million-dollar question is, what's my gift? Well, I don't know. That's between you and God. I think an easy way of putting it is, what are you good at? And what are you good at that other people find they struggle with and you just seem to just do it just like that? Because sometimes I feel people, I feel called to this, but then you step back and go, not that you're trying to judge them, but it doesn't seem to align with what they're saying. Now, I'd better be careful. I'm not trying to say that, Pastor Will, I feel called to the ministry of music. But then the other five of us going, okay. You get what I'm trying to say? So I think as leaders, we have to maybe coach and gently guide to, hey, have you thought about this ministry? Oh, you do really well in this space. So I think that's part of leaders. We've got to encourage and try and suit people into those various positions. But back to the Bible. The Bible says, apostles can spend their time in prayer and teaching of the word. I find it humbling, church, that when the apostles focused, when they almost laid out what their priorities were, they said, hey guys, we need to focus on prayer. And that challenges me as a minister, because I can be so busy running around here and there, and yet when I read the text, the apostle said, our focus is praying. Wow, what a humbling thought. Our focus is in the ministry, the teaching of this book, the scriptures. And I think that's why the church was strong, because they had leaders who were prayed up leaders. Leaders who knew what it was to talk to God. Leaders who knew this beautiful book called the scriptures, but more than that, that they knew the Christ that this scripture pointed to. And so we find there that the Bible says that the apostles say, hey, you guys choose these particular leaders. Can I use a little language that's a little bit closer to home? They had a business meeting. Did you catch what I just said? They had a business meeting. And then more than that, they said, hey, guys, you guys should nominate the leaders. I don't want to step on any toes before this service is over. But there was a process. And I get it. Sometimes as church people, we don't like to get bogged down with processes and how things operate and nominating committees and business meetings and board. It seems like there's a meeting for everything. I know it can be a bit boring sometimes. And some people just flat out told me, I don't want to go to those meetings. That's okay, because I know where they're coming from. Because in many times, meetings are just a lot of talking. But when I look at this, there was purpose to the meeting. They were to select these leaders. And the text goes on to tell us, everyone liked this idea. And they chose the following. Now, you see the names there. I'm not going to try and pronounce them again. Do you know what I find interesting? This is what I kind of found quite humorous, if I could use that word loosely. It says there in verse 5, everyone liked this idea. Can I just give my own kind of reflection on this? I think maybe there were some people that didn't like the idea. Now, I'm not contradicting the Bible, but this is what I think. I think the Holy Spirit is so big. He is so big. He doesn't give you like every detail of what happened. I could probably say of the 3,000, now, don't call me heretical or anything, but here's what I'm suggesting. Maybe there were some people who said, Stephen, why is he one of the deacons? Do you know what I'm trying to say? Because this is what we do in real life. Come on, let's be honest. Come on, let's not play around. But the thing is, I love how the Bible just gives you the outcome. Everyone voted. This is who they chose. It's almost like a minute. You know how we take minutes? We Eileen does minutes and Bev does minutes and, you know, we have meetings and someone's changed. I think like this is kind of like the minutes of what happened in the church. There was a problem. They chose leaders. This is who they chose. But it doesn't tell you everything that happened. It doesn't tell you the conversations. It doesn't tell you what happened and who was upset, who was. It just tells you what the bottom line was. This is who they chose. Now, that's just my personal take on it, okay? If you have a different idea, that's okay. But hey, the Bible says everyone liked it. Okay, everyone liked it. But I was just thinking of that at the same time. So here's who they chose. Stephen, man of full of faith, Holy Spirit, Philip. Did you understand that kind of a connection you can make here? Is all these names are Greek names, which implies that the murmuring came from the Greek-speaking Jewish women. So it kind of makes a connection that if it came from this particular sector of the church, that the leaders that they chose in some way reflected that these leaders would understand the needs of these particular people. I find that very interesting. That leadership should be leaders who understand the people, who know what the people feel like, who know what they go through, right? And in some ways, that's how church operates. We try to select leaders and people in position who have a heart for the people, who understand what they're going through. I just find that interesting that most of those names are there. Greek speak. Okay. Now, we get to 6. Two more verses, and I've got a couple of principles that I'd like to share with you today. It says in verse 6, these 7 men were presented to the apostles who prayed for them as they laid their hands on them. So the apostles recognized the voice of the church and laid their hands on them. Almost a symbol of their call to ministry, that they were called to service and they were called to be leaders in the church. And I love how the Bible ends this sub-story. Oh, should have had another verse over there. That's okay. It says in verse 7, then the word of God spread. I'm just going back to my Bible now. And the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. And it says a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. I find that interesting. Why does the text say priests? Why didn't it just say everyone was obedient? I find that interesting that a very particular comment there is that the priests were obedient to the faith. And so what do we learn from this story? Here's what I learned. I learned that the early church, like churches today, many churches, they had certain problems, right? There were certain challenges in the church. But what did they do about it? The church leaders got together, recognized the situation, and they called a meeting. They said, hey church, let's talk about this together. Let's discuss this. Let's process this together. And as they delegated this task, as it were, to the church, to the body, it was the church that actually selected these individuals, and then God blessed the decision of the church. I think there is some principles that we can make today. Is that just in today's church, there is a way in which we go about leadership. There's a way in which we deal with problems and situations. It's not Pastor Will's show. It's not a one-man, one-woman show. We are leaders. We are together the body of Christ. Amen? So here's kind of 3 things I wanted to share with you right at the end. But 2 principles that are just kind of like I see overarching in the book of Acts. It was a mission-minded church. And so you can't read Acts 6 without reading Acts 1, 2, and 3, and 4. You can't get them choosing and the Spirit leading without the foundations, as it were. There's repentance in Acts 1. There's upper room in Acts 1. There's Day of Pentecost, chapter 2. There's public proclamation, chapter 3. Acts 4, the Bible says that they were praying, the building shook because they'd prayed. You know what I'm saying? So there's a process taking place. And can I say to you, church, that this church in the book of Acts, it's a mission-minded church. But it was also more than a mission-minded church. It was a Spirit-guided church. Because as you can see, it's the Holy Spirit that actually is guiding the decisions. It's guiding the leadership. It's guiding their actions. And so when I look at this New Testament church, I see a church that is solely dedicated to the mission of Christ. And that's the church that I want to be part of. That we're here together because we realize that we're here for a mission, a purpose. Amen? What's the purpose? It's to make disciples. It's to go out into the ends of the earth, as it were. And I like how Jesus' strategy, if you notice what he said in Acts 1:8, he said, you'll be witnesses to me in, does anyone remember the geographic areas? To Jerusalem, Samaria. It's actually the other way around. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Isn't it interesting that Jesus would kind of describe it that way? Because my understanding is when when Jesus spoke those words to the disciples, they weren't thinking beyond Jerusalem. They were just thinking their own little corner of their world. They had no idea that God was basically saying, hey, the mission is to take this to the ends of the earth. And I think sometimes as Christians, we have to realize that this is a global thing we're part of. This is not just this, you know, this right here Jerusalem type of ministry. Did you know that when we did that Easter promotion thing back in April, I went out letterboxing here with those brochures. I just did a Google search and of Para Vista. And you know how if it goes on Google, it gives you like the clear boundaries of where Para Vista starts and ends. Do you know how many people just in this Para Vista area? I think there's a few kind of main roads that kind of 3,000 just here in Para Vista, just Para Vista. And I was saying to myself, wow, 3,000 people live in Para Vista, drive past this church every week, every day. And I'm praying, going, God, how can we reach the 3,000? And I think that's why when we look at the Bible, that's what Jesus was saying to them. Hey, as mind-boggling as it is, God's saying, hey, not just the 3,000, but whole of Adelaide. And maybe more than that, that all of Australia and to the ends of the earth. But here's the thing. When Jesus gave them that vision, perhaps it was too mind-boggling for them to understand. It was too much for them to comprehend. So I guess that's why this idea of prayer had to come in and this idea of wrestling with the Holy Spirit and then the upper room experience so that they were filled with the Spirit, then they could go out and to share what the gospel had done in their lives. Let me wrap this up. So we've got this beautiful story, ends of the earth, Acts 6. What are three things that I think we can learn from the early church? Now, it's not super complicated. What I see here in how the leadership responded, how the whole events unfolded. I think the first thing is the leaders and the actual, well, it's not implied in text. We don't hear any other conversation except what the apostles said in those verses. But here's my take on how the early church were, their characteristics. Number one, I believe there was a certain sense of humility. They were humble. Now, when I say they were humble, it's because they had that upper room experience. You see, the Peter that you see in Acts 2 preaching, the apostles that you see in the book of Acts are not the apostles before the cross. Did you just hear what I said? The apostles that you read in the book of Acts, they are a different people because of the outworking of the Holy Spirit. And part of that process is they had to humble themselves. Peter had to humble himself. Peter had to humble himself before his brethren, before his fellow apostles. So when you see the story, when it came to the apostles didn't say, hey, we've got the answers, right? What did they say? They were humble enough to say, hey, we don't have the answers. I think this is something we need to pray about. Let's pray about this. In fact, church, I think if you guys pray about it, then there'll be some type of consensus. So number one, I thought that they were humble, church, right? Not only were they humble, they had to believe in the mission. You see, when I read this text here, when it looks at Acts 6, what allowed them to come together to a consensus? What was it that brought them together? it was their belief in the mission. And I think that's something that's be well for us to contemplate, is that when it comes to the church and it comes to the dealings of the church, the mission of the church has to trump everything. It has to. It has to be the center of our discussions, in our meetings, in our leadership meetings. Whenever we're talking anything Para Vista related, can I just say to everyone here, and I'm saying to myself, does this move the needle forward for the mission of this church? I think we can all say that we agree with that, but sometimes in practicality, it sometimes doesn't always work, because you know why? Our egos get involved. We somehow feel that, you know, certain decisions will, I don't like it, or, you know, whatever it is. And I think that's why humility has to be part of it. So they had to be humble about it, to say, hey, I don't have the answers. You know, the apostle says, hey, we don't have the answers, but I believe God, yes, we see the problem, but guys, we need to pray about this. So they're humble about it, and they're about to believe in it as well. And the last thing is, I think, how did they come together? Is that they had to build relationships. You see, when you see the early church here, I believe that there is a lot mentioned, there is a lot that is not mentioned in the Bible. The Holy Spirit just kind of gives you a broad stroke of what happened. Like, for instance, when it says they were praying in the upper room, we don't really understand exactly the words that happened. We don't have a line-by-line description of what happened. Certainly, in the book Acts of the Apostles, we are told some of those things that happened, certainly. And I want to encourage you, if you have a copy of that, read Acts of the Apostles. It's a wonderful book. But here's what I'm trying to say. When you look at the early church, I love how it says in Acts 2 that they were in one place, at one accord in one place, the one time. I take that to see that they were able to build relationships with one another. So that when the time came to make those big decisions, they were able to make those decisions because they understood one another. They had time with one another. They were able to build relationships with one another. And that's how we become a church, a team, is that we have to build those relationships. That's why I love all these groups that are happening in the middle of the week. What's it trying to do? It's trying to build community in our church. So when I think about our church, where we're going and what we can learn from this, I think a few things I can see here. Be humble as leaders. I love how the apostle says, hey, we need your help in this. They were humble. They were able to build relationships with one another. The disciples here were a body. They worked together in their... Do you know what I'm saying? I know we believe that, but what strikes me, and I'll just kind of share this with you real quick. If you read Acts chapter 2, when Peter got up to preach that Pentecost sermon, if you read the text closely, go home and read it when you have time, Acts 2, it says that he stood up to preach. It says he stood up with the 11. I love how it says that. But then only Peter preaches. But then at the end of his sermon, the response was, men and brethren, Acts 2, 37, 38, around there. It says, men and brethren, what should we do? And then Peter says, repent and be baptized. What am I trying to say? When Peter got up to preach, I can visualize he was standing there with the 11. But they only heard one voice. I love that picture. That as a church, we comprise ourselves of many people, but it should just be the one voice are speaking. So be humble, build relationships, and believe in the process. Now, as I close, you might be thinking, where is Christ in this story? I don't see Jesus in Acts 1-7. Here's how I'd like to tie in where Christ is. They are there because of Christ. They are there because they spent time in the upper room with Christ. And they were there because Christ's representative, the Holy Spirit, was working in them. Now, I ended on that third thought, believe in the process. You see, the church must believe in the process. But here's another way of putting it, which I love. Did you know that God actually believes in us? Have you ever thought of it that way? A lot of times we try and think, oh, I've got to put my faith in God. I've just really got to trust. And it's true. But have you ever seen it from the other aspect? That God looks at you and he says, I believe in you. I have faith in you. And so just as we are to believe in the process, believing that God is leading and directing us in that church, could it be that God's actually doing the same thing? He's saying, I believe in you, Para Vista Church. I know you can do it. This message of preaching the gospel, you got this. In fact, the reason why you've got this is because I said I'll be with you. So you don't have to worry about it. Just stick with me through this. And so I believe in the process. Can we be looked two ways? It's us believing in God, but more so, God actually looks at us and says, my child, my daughter, believe in the process. Believe that I'm with you. Believe that when I tell you you'll go to the ends of the earth, I'll be with you to the very end of the age. And so we've got to believe that. If we don't believe that, then why are we here? So at some point, we've got to believe this for ourselves. Believe that this church, that there's a process. There's a reason why we have meetings. There's a reason why we have process. There's a reason why we have elders. There's a reason why we have a board. Yeah, you may not understand everything that happens under the church structure, but just believe in the process. God's leading it. I may not understand everything in the church manual, but I believe it. The church manual is not the gospel, but I believe that God has inspired leaders to articulate how things happen, how things govern, and guess what? I may not even agree with some of it. That's okay. But as long as you're in the body, we may have differences, church. We may have differences of how we do church, of how we do leadership, how we do worship. That's okay. As long as we all know we're on the same team, we're all on the same mission, serving the same Jesus. And if we all under that, I'm with you. You're my brother. Remember what Jesus said in that story when he came down from the Mount Transfiguration and there was other people calling out demons in Jesus' name? Remember those other disciples saying, hey, Jesus, he's not one of us. Remember how Jesus responded? He basically said, that guy's with us. He may not be your stripe and denomination and persuasion, but he's one of us. I think sometimes we've got to balance our idea of uniqueness, also realizing, hey, did you know that there's two churches across the road? Right there, boom. And I sometimes think about that. Driving into the driveway, one, two, three, all in. And I say to myself, well, it's God's business. We're all the body of Christ. Those people there worshiping Jesus, praising Jesus, loving Jesus. Sometimes, look, this is part of confession time. Sometimes like, oh, well, they're not Adventists. We get like that sometimes as SDAs, right? Sorry, I'm going a bit over time. But at the same time, we have to understand that we're here for a mission. We're here for a purpose. And so I guess my burden in my heart this morning, why are we casting that vision? Why are we telling people to grow? Why are we telling people to give? Because it's based on this. It's based on the Bible. What happens in Acts 6? There were problems in the church. How did they deal with it? They set up a meeting. Now, I know that we don't like meetings, but it's a necessary part of how we function. I don't just sit home in my room and go, we're going to do this and this and this. Here you go, guys. I think that's to some degree how the secular world operates. Isn't that right sometimes? If a new leader comes into a new business, they fire people straight away. Isn't that what the previous, who's that new guy? Maniscalcus or something? The politician guy. Don't they just come in and just sweep out the whole leadership? Now, we don't do that in church world, do we? We don't do that. Why? Because we are a body of Christ. Ah, I'm taking too long. Thank you for listening. I hope you've heard the burden on my heart. We work together. We build relationships. Remain humble. I don't have the answers. I don't claim to know the answers. I'm so glad I get to work with leadership teams like Eileen and Glendon, wherever Glendon is. And I shouldn't be naming names, but we have a beautiful team here. If we can just cultivate that, when problems happen, let's talk about it. How can we move forward in it? What's the best for this church? What's the mission of the church? And if we do that humbly, I believe by God's grace, this church will go where God needs it to go. Thank you for listening, and I'll pass the time back to our worship team. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Pastor Will. Please rise and sing with us. Our last song is Calvary.
The Savior alone carrying the cross for all of my debts. He paid the cost. Salvation complete. Now and forever I'm free. Calvary covers it all. Covers it all, my sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. Power on earth, not even the grave can save. Faithful to save, oh, his blood never fails. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. No one but Jesus can make us pure as snow. We stand in your freedom. Sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. All praise to the one who has ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all.
Amen, amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for Calvary. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for the gospel, the good news, what Jesus has done for us. We thank you for what he's doing for us right now. We thank you that one day soon he's coming back to take us home. And Lord, I just pray for every person here today that they would have accepted the gift of Calvary, the gift of Jesus, the gift of his sacrifice of his own life, so that we would be set free. We thank you, Lord, that you love this world so much that you gave your one and only Son. Whoever believes in the name of Jesus and his life will not perish. We will have everlasting life. And so, Father, help us to grasp that by faith, to accept that awesome gift, free gift of grace that comes from your Son. May we live in the light of the cross, in the light of the gospel. May we change this world for Christ and for his glory, we pray. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you so much for being here today, for worshiping here with us. we are now just going to be splitting up into our different small groups. So we invite you all to join a group now. And if you missed out the announcement at the beginning of the service, another reminder of our church lunch that will be happening next Sabbath, which we would love you all to join. So feel free to bring a plate to share, and we'd love to see you then. So enjoy the rest of your day, and we hope to see you next Sabbath. Thank you.